In the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, one God, Amen. Glory be to the Father, to the Son, to the Holy Spirit, now and ever, unto the ages of ages, Amen. Welcome back to our sixth session. You made it so far, halfway. We have 12 sessions altogether, not counting the spring break. There's one week where we're not going to be meeting, just to get a little bit of a break, but actually in total, our meetings are 12. So now we're in the sixth, which is we're halfway through our New Testament course. And I pray that this has been a blessing to all of us, including myself, as we dig deeper into the Word of God and understand. And it's really important as we go through this course that we're not only perceiving the Word of God from a historical perspective or an academic perspective, but the main purpose of pursuing this course is to align our mind with our faith and to benefit from the two of them together, to dig deeper into the Word, understand the circumstances, the history, and everything that was happening at the time. And this would be a means for us to reach deeper as we study the Word of God in following times, Lord willing. Tonight we're going to be speaking about the Gospel of John. And again, we mentioned before, the first three Gospels are called the Synoptic Gospels because they are seen together. You can combine them together, and more or less the same storyline are followed in all three Gospels, the same more or less miracles, wonders, teachings by Christ. And we went through all three of them, and we cannot combine the three of them because each one is a distinct image or picture of the Lord Jesus Christ. But still, the first three Gospels we can see together, and they follow more or less the same outline. When it comes to the Gospel of John, he is in a class by himself. Yeah, he didn't follow the same kind of life story of Christ, even though, yes, we get snippets, again, from the same ministry or following the same storyline, kind of. But his approach was completely different than all the other ones. That's why he is not included in this group of Gospels called the Synoptic Gospel. It's just the Gospel of John. As we do every week, we're going to start with a few definitions. Okay? And these words are important for us as we develop our theological vocabulary. This is important. So we know exactly when we mention a word, what do we mean by this specific word. You could have heard this word several times in many contexts, but we want to define them in a way that when we reference these words, we know exactly what we are referring to, so that there is no confusion in speaking about these words. The first important word that's going to be mentioned concerning the Gospel of John is the word logos. Logos. And from it comes the English word logic. But what is logos in Greek? It's in Greek philosophy, actually, this word was spoken of many centuries before the incarnation of the word. Before our Lord Jesus came and took human flesh, the Greek philosophers spoke about the logos. And in Greek philosophy, it's a word that refers to the ultimate truth or reason. Now, keep in mind that the Greek philosophers did not believe in God. So they were not Christians. They were not Jews. Maybe they believed in some mythology. They believed in philosophy, things that you can think of. But the Greek philosophers thought of something that is much bigger and greater than what is in this temporal world. He was not called God, per se, but they just believed that there is an ultimate truth or reason. What is the source of all of this reason that is in the world, or truth, or philosophy, or wisdom? Where does it come from? They thought that there is a source for all of this wisdom and truth and reason. So this ultimate source of truth and reason and wisdom, they called it or him the Logos. Okay, so the ultimate truth or reason. In the first century, as St. John began to write his gospel, of course, through the guidance of the Holy Spirit, he wanted to engage the Greeks into what they knew as the ultimate logic. So he began his gospel with this amazing introduction, which we'll speak about in more detail in a minute, which when we speak about the prologue of the gospel. And he said, in the beginning was the Logos, and the Logos was with God, and the Logos was God. Okay, this was in the beginning. So he used the same word Logos 3 times in the first verse or two verses. In the beginning was the Logos, and the Logos was with God, and the Logos was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him, and without him nothing was made that was made. And then in verse 14, he would go back and say, and the Logos became flesh. So again, 4 times that word Logos is mentioned in chapter 1, basically in verse 1 and also in verse 14. And in the Christian context, when we say the word Logos, we are referring to the eternal divine entity that became the human being, Jesus Christ, our Lord. So there's an advancing or advancement in the use of the term Logos. In Greek philosophy, it is in reference or an abstract reference to an ultimate truth or reason, the source, okay, without personifying it. But in Christianity, we're specifically speaking about the incarnation or the coming of the Lord Jesus. Which takes us to the second word that we're going to be identifying or defining tonight, which is the word incarnation. A very important word to be known in Christian theology and understanding, which is the incarnation. Even Saint Athanasius, his famous book called On the Incarnation, okay? A very important term. What is incarnation? It's the Christian doctrine that God became a human being in the person of Jesus Christ. God, who is eternal, who lives from the beginning, okay, as it says, in the beginning. Which beginning are we speaking about here? Eternity, okay? So this beginning is different than the beginning mentioned in the book of Genesis, okay? So in the book of Genesis, it says, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. So that word beginning there refers to the beginning of creation. As for the beginning of the Gospel of John, when he speaks about the beginning, in the beginning, this is eternity. Okay, we cannot know when is this beginning. It's from eternity and unto eternity. So the eternal God, at a certain time in the history of humanity, in the perfect time, as mentions in Galatians 4:4, the fullness of time, God took human flesh through the Virgin Mary, came and lived on earth and dwelt amongst us in order to show us an exemplary lifestyle, to show us the perfection of virtues, but also to redeem us, to die on our behalf, and to give us eternal life. So that whole concept is called the mystery of the incarnation. God becoming human and taking on human flesh in the person of our Lord Jesus Christ. A third word that we need to learn also for tonight is the word paraclete. And parakletos, okay? We use this word quite often in the liturgy, in the Akveya prayer, the liturgy of the hours. And we refer to the Holy Spirit as the paraclete. Even we use the word paraclete, we do not, there are certain Greek words that we still continue to use in our liturgy because there isn't a specific English word that can embody the entire meaning of this word. Like you can't translate it and say, this is exactly what it means in English. There is no equivalent word in English to the word paraclete. But often it is a name of the Holy Spirit used in the Gospel of John, and it's translated in English as the comforter, the counselor, the advocate, or the helper, or all of the above. So it embodies all of these meanings together. The word advocate really literally means the lawyer, okay? Like a lawyer. Even in Arabic sometimes we use the word avocado. Not the avocado that we eat, There's another kind of avocado, actually. They refer, like an advocate. It comes from the word advocate. The avocado, in reference to the lawyers. I know I have some lawyers there. So, so that's the meaning. So the lawyer or the counselor, okay, or someone who would speak on your behalf, this is the reference to the word paraclete. But he's also a comforter because he gives you peace, right? And the helper, the one who assists you in time of need. So all of these words together embody the word paraclete in Greek, or parakletos. And then the final section of our discussion tonight is going to deal with a subject called Mariology. Okay, we've done before several ologies. Do you remember them? We defined theology. We defined what else? Christology. We defined soteriology, right? Doctrine of salvation. Okay, what else? And pneumatology. Pneuma is the Holy Spirit. Okay, so the doctrine of the Holy Spirit. Did we do other ologies? Eschatology. So what is eschatology? The doctrine of the end of times. What will happen at the end of times, right? Any other ologies? Biology? The study of all living things, right? No, but that's not part of our course. Anyhow, so now we're doing Mariology. Mariology is the doctrine of the church concerning Saint Mary. Okay, what do we believe, who Saint Mary is, and it answers questions related to her ever virginity. Okay, we're going to deal with that in the second half, God willing. Being called Theotokos, literally the word Theotokos does not mean mother of God. It means bearer of God. Okay, the one who bore God in her womb, intercession, and her dormition or assumption. It also clarifies the role of Saint Mary in human salvation. There has to be over the centuries different opinions concerning the role of Saint Mary. We're not going to dig very deep into Mariology. Again, we're just basically defining some of these terms so that when they are referenced in front of us, we know exactly what we are speaking about. Now, having defined a few terms which will help us in our discussion tonight, let's turn to the Gospel of John and start to dig deeper in its knowledge. Who is John? The author, the Gospel is named after John. The John we are specifically speaking about is the son of Zebedee and Salome. And he is also the brother of James the Greater. In the Gospel, the two brothers are often called after their father, the sons of Zebedee. And they received from Christ the honorable title of Boanerges. And we spoke about it when we spoke about the Gospel of Mark, which literally means the sons of thunder, because he had so much passion and knowledge concerning the faith. So this was the names that were given by our Lord Jesus to them. John was one of the privileged disciples, along with Peter and James, who were close followers of Christ. They were the only witnesses of the raising of Jairus' daughter, the story mentioned in Mark 5:37. And they were also there in the Transfiguration in Matthew 17:1, and of the prayer in Gethsemane towards the end of the Lord's life according to the flesh in Matthew 26:37. It's really quite unique to know that John is the one who has placed or who sat beside our Lord Jesus during the Last Supper, and whose chest he leaned on. Again, he experienced firsthand the love of Christ, and it's so amazing to know that he called himself the disciple whom Christ loved. And it's quite remarkable. Maybe this is our small meditation for tonight, is the fact that when we experience Christ's love, we feel that he loves us so much personally that even I'm spoiled by him, I'm loved by him. So that amazing interaction of emotion between a disciple and a master could only be felt when there's a relationship. And again, the way that John presents this gospel, in most of the interactions which take on long discourses, Like if you remember, Mark was rush, 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 and this happened immediately, and this happened immediately. In the Gospel of John, it's actually quite the opposite. There are very few signs or miracles or interactions with Christ, and they take on very long time, very long chapters. You have the chapter of the Samaritan woman, huge. The man who was born blind, huge. And you have many more interactions, the Good Shepherd in chapter 10, and so many other interactions between Christ and the people, because this gospel is a relational gospel. It's more about a disciple and a master or a teacher who are in perfect harmony in a loving and caring relationship. St. John also remained near the master at the foot of the cross on Calvary with the Virgin Mary and all the pious women. While all of the other disciples fled away and were afraid for their lives, he was the only one who remained with the Virgin Mary, and that's why this is the only gospel that says to us that the Lord Jesus gave him a beautiful gift in the Virgin Mary to take care of her, and he told her, this is going to be your son, and he told him that this is going to be your mother. So he took her into his care at the request of the Lord Jesus in chapter 19, verses 25 to 27. He was, after the death and resurrection of Christ in the book of Acts, we see that he was also there and present. He was in the company of St. Peter at the healing of the lame man in the temple in Acts 3:1, and was also thrown in prison with St. Peter in Acts 4:3. You find him also a little bit later in the book of Acts, chapter 8, verse 14. He was with the apostles visiting the newly converted Christians in Samaria as the word of God started to spread out of Jerusalem and Judea and into Samaria. Now, I know that the book that we are currently reading, Powell, consists a lot of new scholarship concerning and the questioning of the author and when the book was written and all of these things, which is, I find, important for us to know. There's no problem in reading modern scholarship. As for us as Orthodox Christians, we usually abide by the writings and the doctrines and the sayings of the early church fathers, where this tradition grew and the gospels were named after certain disciples. There was never any confusion or questioning. Of course, we have to keep in mind that the actual text of these scriptures does not identify who the author is. But early on in the church, it became known and settled which disciple wrote which book and scripture, and it became known in the worldwide church until very recently, probably in the 20th century, with modern scholarship, that started to be questioning on who is the real author and all of these things. Anyhow, according to our tradition, we know that John is the author. He was the last one to write, the gospel, or the last gospel amongst the four that are canonized. And probably in or around the ending or conclusion of the first century, between the year 90 and 100. He is also the author of other scriptures, so in total 5 books of the New Testament, so the Gospel of John, and then you have 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John, and also the book of Revelation, where he actually identifies himself in that book as John, and being in the Spirit in the Lord's Day, and seeing the beautiful revelation that he now left for us. And the entire Gospel is 21 chapters, which is very scholarly gospel, very deep, and as identified in the book that we're reading in Powell, that it's one of the deepest books because it's got a lot of talk about the depth of the divinity and so many other topics that every time someone reads this gospel, you can dig in deeper into spirituality, into knowledge, into theology. And it is usually the first book that anyone reads. Like, let's say if there's a new Christian and we just want to give them something to read from Scripture, usually these little tracts, you give them out the Gospel of John. because it speaks so beautifully about the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Again, a Trinitarian gospel, but also so much more, which we are going to investigate together in a few minutes. Let's look at a quick outline of the Gospel of John. The first part, there are mainly four parts to the Gospel, an outline, and then we will speak about the Gospel or the Book of Signs, and then the Book of Glory, and then finally the epilogue, which is the conclusion of the book. So let's begin with the beautiful introduction of this Gospel, which is the prologue. And it's basically the very first 18 verses in chapter 1. St. John doesn't go much or at all into the birth narrative. Okay, we only find them in two Gospels, which are, which ones? You should be experts by now. Huh? Matthew and Luke. Yeah, Matthew and Luke are the two Gospels that have spoken in some detail concerning the birth of Christ. As for the Gospel of John, he goes into his eternal birth or his eternal existence, the one who was begotten before all ages, the only begotten of the Father, was before all ages, came and was incarnate of the Virgin. In the beginning was the Word, or the Logos. Okay, that word Logos is translated into Word with a capital W. And here he is appealing to a Greek-speaking philosophical community who might have already some knowledge of the concept of the Logos, okay? Eternal truth, eternal knowledge, but have never actually understood what this Logos is. It's a very philosophical concept to them. So imagine, as a Jew, he is writing to the Greeks and appealing to them and finding common grounds where they could both stand on. So when he says, in the beginning was the Logos, the Greek-speaking culture, they say, okay, we understand. That's, you know, our philosophers have spoken about it almost 500 to 600 years before the coming of Christ. And then he gives them the second part of that verse. And the Word, or the Logos, was with God. So when he speaks about God, he's speaking now about the Hebrew God, right? It could have been like the Jehovah God, but of course he's writing in Greek, so he's not writing Jehovah, he's writing God, okay? So you're speaking about the Greek concept, and then this Logos, okay, is with God, the Hebrew God, the Almighty God. They said, okay, that's a little bit maybe confusing, but okay, we can accept that. And then he hits them with the third concept, and the Logos was God. So now he married two things together. And he is saying that that Logos that your philosophers have spoken about for 500 or 600 years is our own God, and now is revealed through the person of Jesus Christ, our Lord. This Word, this Logos, is actually God. And he comes back in verse 14 and says, and the Logos became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. Again, he introduces them to the third level, which is Jesus Christ, who is God, God Almighty. And this Logos is actually Jesus Christ, who has taken on human flesh, came, was incarnate, and we beheld him, and we beheld his glory. This glory, as it is very unique, not like anyone else. We beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, monogenes, okay, the only begotten of the Father. In Holy Week, we have a hymn called O Monogenes, right? The only begotten of the Father, full of grace and of truth. So we start out with the Logos. In the beginning was the Logos, they understood that. And the Logos was with God, okay? He's introducing to them the concept, understanding, or the understanding of Christian theology, and the divinity of Christ, that Logos was with God. And the Logos was God, that means he was actually that God that has been spoken about for centuries within the Hebrews, and the Greeks are speaking about the Logos. Actually, these two things amount to the same one and only God. And that Logos, the ever-existing, Jesus is actually Jesus Christ, our Lord, who came on earth, took human flesh, dwelt amongst us, and we all beheld his glory as the glory of the only begotten of the Father. That's why this amazing introduction is one of the most powerful, maybe throughout scriptures. There's been other introductions concerning the divinity of Christ throughout, especially the epistles, but amongst the gospels, that is one of the most profound introductions concerning who Jesus Christ is. So again, the whole concept of Christology and soteriology and the understanding of the Holy Trinity all combined together in this very powerful introduction to the Gospel of John. The second part is the book of signs. As we had mentioned before, previously, when we spoke about Matthew and then Mark and Luke, we said that John doesn't use the word miracles. He uses the word signs more or exclusively. So that's why we see that word signs is repeated so many times, especially, let's say, in the beginning of chapter 2, in the miracle of the wedding of Cana of Galilee and changing the water into wine. We read the following. At the conclusion of the miracle in chapter 2, verse 11, this beginning of signs Jesus did in Cana of Galilee. So again, miracles are called signs in the Gospel of John. So that part of the Gospel goes through so many signs and miracles to show again the authority of Christ and to reflect not only his divinity but also his humanity. Because in this section we'll see that in the beautiful story of raising of Lazarus, we see that Jesus cries and he shows emotions, and sometimes he's upset, and of course eventually at the end of the gospel he dies. So these are all human emotions that he goes through. So it's not only that John is focusing on his divinity, but he's also focusing on his humanity. I hope we received the little video clip from Bishop Kirolos this week. Did you all receive it by email? Yes? Okay. I hope you had a chance to view it. His Grace wasn't able, his flight was delayed last week. He wasn't able to be with us. So I requested from him if he can record for us. And indeed, he was so gracious to record for us the explanation, that understanding of the divinity and humanity of Christ, that it's okay theologically to have this understanding that these two things do not contradict with one another. A lot of people have been asking about verses that speak about Jesus's humanity and then speak about Jesus's divinity. How could these two things combine and we can understand them with our human logic? I thought of something actually that happened with me a couple of years ago. I visited a place in north of Alaska. It's in the Northwest Territories. It's called Inuvik. And that place actually is a beautiful place, because I think I mentioned it here once before. It's like right at the top of the globe, right? So in the summer, the sun never sets. So you have 24 hours of daylight, right? So it could be 11 o'clock at night, or midnight, or 1 o'clock, 1 a.m., and you look up in the sky and you see the sun on this side and the moon on that side. It's very strange. So one of the ways that I thought about it is that our bodies are used to relate nighttime with darkness, right? Like, this is our human logic. So in this specific place, it's against the human logic, because it's nighttime, but it's actually daylight. Okay? So if I'm in that place of the world, I'm speaking of nighttime, okay? I can speak of nighttime. But when I come to speak about darkness and light, I'm speaking about it from the perspective that there is light, it's not darkness. So how can you mentally or logically understand these two things that could be in a paradox, or you cannot combine them together, but actually they do exist, okay? You can have nighttime and it's light, or the sun is shining at midnight, both at the same time, without contradiction between being 11 p.m. and without being, you know, shining sun as if it's 12 noon. With a human logic, it might not make sense, okay? But actually, it's a reality. It's the same way when we speak about the understanding of the divinity and the humanity of Christ. You can be fully God and you can be fully human without contradiction with one another. And we can say, Jesus Christ, the incarnate Word of God, suffered according to the flesh, but He is still God Almighty, or He died according to the flesh, as we heard in the explanation of Bishop Carollo. So a very important part of this gospel is that you're going to see very clearly the divinity and humanity of Christ without any contradiction to both of them. There's no problem at all with the incarnate Word of God who cries at the tomb of Lazarus, but also who says, "The Father, I and the Father are one," or he speaks about the Logos taking human flesh, etc. The Book of Signs is divided up into a few passages. First, we begin with the witness of John, which is very important testimony. You have a question? Okay, I'll give you the mic if you don't mind, so everyone can hear.
Okay, it's kind of a weird question. So you're talking about the divinity and humanity of Christ and how it's not in contradiction and all that. So can you explain how that differs in terms of us?
So for us, we are mere humans. And we are susceptible to sin. So as a creation, God gave us free will. And unfortunately, humanity fell into sin, and sin entered into the world, as we say in the Divine Liturgy. And we were in need of a Savior. So the only Savior is God Almighty. And in the New Testament, His nature was revealed to us where it was not revealed before. So again, because of that introduction of John that spoke about the eternal Logos, so God is eternal. We are created. God chose to take human flesh in order to redeem us. As we said before, whatever God does not assume, He cannot redeem or save. So the perfect one assumed human flesh, and He also carried our sins. So it's not that He was sinful or a sinner in Himself, but He carried the sins of the world. And as Colossians also speaks about nailing it on the cross, and He nailed it on the cross. So what's the difference between us and Christ? Actually, St. Athanasius said that He has taken what is ours to give us what is His. So what is God's by nature, He gave us through adoption. Okay, but let me explain that part because it could be a little bit misunderstood. So by nature, God is divine, the triune God that we believe in. He created humanity and in the fullness of time took on that human flesh to redeem us. In order to do what? To return us back to the original state that we were created upon in the likeness and image of God. So, what is the difference between us and God? He is the creator, we are the creation. He is divine, but we are limited. But because of His grace and faith in Him, He gave us as a gift eternal life, to be to live in His presence forever and ever. So, again, the incarnation is from on top coming down to us. in order to lift us and to bring us up to the Father by His grace. Is it clear or confusing still? Bit by bit, okay. So again, like I mean, the big part in understanding here is that He is the Almighty Creator, and all happens through Him. But by grace, He would take us out of our, or redeem us from our sinful nature, and bring us up to the first estate that we were created upon before the fall of Adam and Eve. Clarification? Okay. We were made in His likeness, okay. So what's the difference in our nature, you mean? Or?
Because we're both as well, right?
Okay, but we are not divine.
So no, but we have, it's like...
We have the breath?
Yes.
The breath
which comes
of God.
From God, so is it not sure. The same?
No, the breath of God is different than His divinity. I'm sorry. The breath of God is the breath of life. So He breathed life into us. And He gave us His Holy Spirit as a guide.
So can I just continue with something? Like, because I'm getting confused with, I guess, what we believe and different things. So in terms of, like, science, mm-hmm. for example, if you were to bridge them together, so like if you were to think of a holographic kind of universe, are we not a drop kind of thing? Are we not like a drop from the ocean? Is it not the same thing in a way? Like how do I'm having a hard time understanding things. since I've been exposed to more things, it's just I'm a little confused, and I was wondering if you could.
Are you referring to the drop in the ocean in terms of like the human existence, or in terms of the universe, like where does the Earth and its inhabitants fall in terms of the whole universe?
I think more like spiritually.
Spiritually, okay.
Like what we are, like so, our essence.
Okay, our essence as human beings, we are a body, of course, this is easy, right? And then a spirit, and this spirit is what connects us with God. Because animals and other creatures do not have that ability to connect with God. So through that logos, through that intellect, we're able to connect with God and to worship the creator of the universe. And then there is the Holy Spirit, who is God, who is one of the persons of the Holy Trinity.
So can I just, I don't mean to do this, okay, but, okay. Okay, so you said that the animals don't connect with God, so how do you mean exactly?
Like they're unable intellectually or in any...
Like consciously.
Consciously.
Okay.
To connect with God, or to, you know, to pray, or to attain salvation, or
but
so they don't have that soul that connects them with
God.
But in
terms of God guiding them, I mean, I believe.
Yeah, of
that,
course.
Okay.
Of course, God is the ruler of the entire universe, and all of the creation reflects His glory and His image, and He has placed like in each animal or even trees or birds or any creation, its ability to sustain itself, the seed to procreate, several instincts, you know, in order to defend themselves, all of these things. But there is no clear understanding of any connection with God or eternal life or salvation. So that would be the main difference between us and other creatures on the earth, is that that breath of life. Like all of the other creatures are just created by God. But when it came to the humans, God breathed into them life and they became alive. So that's the spirit that came into them to connect them with God. we can continue the conversation if I'm not
answering
exactly what it is. Okay. All right, so the Book of Signs, Christ reveals the Father in it, and you see the witness of John, the first disciples, wedding of Cana, cleansing the temple, a summary by John's in his ministry, discussion about the new birth, okay, the interaction with Nicodemus, a beautiful discussion on what it means to believe in Christ, a final witness of John the Baptist. I might have to go a little bit faster just to finish that segment before the break. We have a beautiful discourse of Jesus with the Samaritan woman, dialogue with the disciples, the life-giving word discussion. Again, the bread of life is so important to, even though there's no Last Supper mentioned in the Gospel of John, it's mentioned in the other Gospels, but the discussion of Jesus with his disciples concerning the bread of life is actually so profound and important, the importance of partaking of the body and blood of Christ. Unless you partake of the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. And to the point that some of his disciples walked away and didn't continue following him. And Jesus was willing to let go of these disciples even if they didn't believe in that transformation or change of partaking of the body and blood of Christ. And we have signs and teachings, especially in chapter 9, 10, and 11, concerning the man born blind. You have the Good Shepherd, and also a discussion about the last days of Christ on earth. In around the beginning of chapter 13, you find a change of direction, which is more a beautiful, beautiful dialogue or a monologue, actually teachings about Christ's return to the Father. So you have a discussion with the disciples, you have the washing of the feet, which is quite remarkable. It's love in action, because love is not just a word and emotion that we say, but you see that Jesus actually goes down and he starts washing the disciples' feet. And he tells them that he is the way, the truth, and the life, and speaking about the paraclete, him being the true vine, and how they can overcome through his name. Again, one of the most beautiful prayers in all of the scriptures is the intercessory prayer in John chapter 17, where he speaks to the Father and he prays not only for himself, but also he prays for all of his disciples and followers. That's really remarkable. I do not pray that you may take them away from the world, but that you may keep them from the evil one. Then we enter into the passion narrative and, of course, the resurrection narrative, until we come to the final segment, which is the epilogue, the breakfast by the sea. Jesus restores Peter and he asks them three times, "Do you love me?" And by the way, this part, again, unless we read the Greek, we might not know exactly what he's saying. In this part, Jesus, you know, the word that's translated into love in English, there are three words that mean love. The first one is agape, or agapeos, which means the sacrificial kind of love. And the second one is philia. Okay? Philia is the brotherly love. And then we have the eros. We just celebrated Valentine's yesterday. Happy Valentine's. And you have the little, naked angel. Named Cupid, right? Cupid. So Cupid in the Roman culture is equivalent to Eros in the Greek culture, okay? The god of love. But actually it's the sensual kind of love. Okay? Sensual love, so almost sinful kind of love. The one that desires to take rather than to give. This one, Eros, is not mentioned in the New Testament, but the first two are mentioned in the New Testament. So when Jesus is speaking with Peter, he's telling him, do you agapeos me? Do you love me with a pure sacrificial kind of love? And then Peter answers him and he says, yes, I, not agapeos, I philia you. He answers him with the word philia. Okay? So it's like to say, someone goes, let's say, to his fiance and he says, I love you, love you, love you so much. And then she says, I like you too. You're okay. Right? Like, he'd kind of be disappointed. That's actually what happened in that interaction in John 21. The second time Jesus asks, do you agape me? And Peter says, yes, I feel you. And then the third time, Jesus actually says, do you feel me? And Peter answers, yes, I feel you. So he kind of downgraded his type of love a little bit, because Peter maybe hadn't received, he was still being restored, he hadn't received the Holy Spirit as of yet. He went down to his level the third time, and Peter still answered him with the same kind of brotherly love. But finally they are restored, and the gospel closes with a beautiful statement that there's so much more that Jesus said and done. If it was all counted and written, all of the books in the whole world would not be enough to actually fill all of these books. What's the purpose of writing the gospel? To establish Jesus' role as the Messiah and as the Savior. Secondly, to defend the faith intellectually against criticism brought about by the Jews. Thirdly, it was a tool for evangelism to convert either Jews or Samaritans, and also used as a catechism to teach new converts into the faith to help them learn about the Lord Jesus Christ. The purpose for writing the gospel is also to establish Jesus' superiority over all of the other religious leaders, whether they are the Greek philosophers, whether they are the Jewish leaders. Jesus' authority or superiority above all of them is established. Let's speak a bit about some of the highlights of the gospel. There's no infancy narrative, but an immediate reference to the Lord's divinity. That's something that we have discussed already, and it's so remarkable about this gospel. Also, it points out the fact that the ministry of Christ lasted for 3 years. We see throughout the gospel of John a celebration of three Passovers in 2:13, 6:4, and 11:55. That's how we know that Jesus' life on earth was about 33 years or so, because a Jewish teacher would start his ministry at the age of 30, and this gospel took us through three Passovers, which takes us to 33 years. That is the main reference. We all know the life of Jesus Christ. There's so many beautiful long discourses. First one, a discourse is a long teaching or a long conversation. First one was with Nicodemus in 3:1-21, and then you have the Samaritan woman in chapter 4, the healing of the paralytic at Bethsaida, chapter 5, the bread of life, chapter 6, the man who was born blind, chapter 9, and then the good shepherd, chapter 10, and then you have Mary and Martha and the raising of Lazarus in chapter 11. In this gospel, Christ speaks of concepts like truth, very important, light, life, and by the way, if you look at all of the writings of John, there are three words that are repeated throughout that all start with the letter L: love, light, and life. These three are really important. When we come to the epistles a little bit later in a couple of weeks, Lord willing. And also the Word. So our Lord Jesus aimed to teach that God's eternal truth had become incarnated for the salvation of humankind in the events that happened once and for all. So these events that happened in the life of Christ are not to be repeated again throughout history. It was a one-time deal. It's not that something or someone else could take on human flesh, or God can take on human flesh. No, he is the only begotten of the Father. The main role of the Paraclete, we spoke that this is a name of the Holy Spirit, is to reveal the truth and to teach the disciples what they need to know. He will lead also all believers into the new revelation, and he testifies on behalf of our Lord Jesus, especially chapters 14 and 16. And some of these chapters, or all of these chapters, 14, 15, 16, and 17, they are called the readings of the Paraclete, and they are read who knows when during the Holy Week. on the eve of Friday. Okay, the eve of Friday. These are the readings of the Gospels. We read all of them, and they are so, so beautiful, and just representing the beautiful intimate relationship between us and the Holy Trinity. We can label this gospel as the gospel of love. It teaches God's love to the world and also love towards one another. Some of the verses that everyone almost exclusively knows and learns by heart. John 3:16. Who has John 3:16 written on their like shoes or some a football player who used to do? Anyone knows? Tim Tebow, yeah. Tim Tebow used to write John 3:16. And he had some nice incidents with 3:16 back in the day. Tim Tebow, yes. So, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. And then our theme from last year, 13, 34, and 35, a new commandment I give to you, that you love one another as I have loved you, that you also love one another. By this all will know that you are my disciples if you have love for one another. So that's a really important theme, not only of the gospel, but of all of the other writings in the New Testament of St. John. We spoke a bit in the beginning concerning a focus on the divinity of Christ. So his proclamation that the Logos was God or is God. And also after the resurrection, Thomas confesses, my Lord and my God. This is really important, okay? That after the resurrection, it proved to him that he is indeed not just a good teacher or a rabbi, but he is God and he worshipped him. That's really important. The one who accepts worship has to be only God Almighty. He proclaimed saying, I am in the Father and the Father is in me. Very important to our understanding of his divinity. And also in 10:3 he would say, the Father and I are one. But Jesus is also shown as human. Okay, he cries, he's fatigued, he's tired, in anguish, he's thirsty, and ultimately he dies. Again, all that understanding, Christological understanding of his humanity and his divinity. He sees also salvation as abundant life. And again, just like we spoke about Luke before, that when we speak about the word salvation, doesn't only mean that it's something to come in the age to come, in the eschaton. But actually, salvation is part of our life. So Jesus is coming to set us free at the age which we are in now, at the current age. So salvation has different meanings. Okay, whenever it's mentioned, it speaks about abundant life here on earth, but also the whole concept of forgiveness of sins and eternal life, which is in the age to come. People can become children of God. They can be saved. They can enter God's kingdom. They are born again. They can come to the Father and be set free. And our theme verse for this year, okay, last year and this year, are both from Gospel of John. I have come that they may have life. They may have it more abundantly. One of the really interesting things about the Gospel of John, that it is a sacramental gospel. A sacramental gospel, actually, you can find all seven sacraments of the church in this particular gospel. First of all, in 3:5, he would speak about being born again. Jesus answered, most assuredly I say to you, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. So again, that whole discourse and discussion with Nicodemus led us to the knowledge of being born again through water and of Spirit, which is the holy baptism. In 13:8-10, he would speak about the sacrament of confession. And very quickly, he would say, Peter said to him, you shall never wash my feet. Jesus answered him, if I do not wash you, you have no part with me. Simon Peter said to him, Lord, not only my feet, but also my hands and my head. Jesus said to him, he who is bathed needs only to wash his feet, but is completely clean. and you are clean, but not all of you. So again, the whole concept that, no, I'm not going to be washed all over again, just my feet, that the church interprets as the need only for confession or the sacrament of confession and repentance. Again, communion in 6:51 to 68, that whole dialogue and discourse concerning the importance of partaking of the Lord's flesh and his blood, and unless we partake of it, we have no life in us. So that's communion. And then we look at holy matrimony. The very first sign of Jesus Christ was at the wedding of Cana of Galilee, and the church says that through the presence of our Lord Jesus at the wedding of Cana of Galilee, he has blessed holy matrimony. In 20:22 to 23, our Lord Jesus gives the Holy Spirit to the disciples and establishes priesthood. And he breathes into the faces of his holy disciples and says to them the following: receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained. And then you have the sacrament of chrismation in chapter 12 and verse 3. That says the following: Then Mary took a pound of very costly oil of spikenard, anointed the feet of Jesus, and wiped his feet with her hair, and the house was filled with the fragrance of the oil. So here you find the chrismation oil and the fragrance, so that's also very important. And finally, the unction of the sick, as our Lord Jesus healed many sick who were coming after him. And that establishes again the sacrament of the holy unction of the sick. Specifically, I can read for you from chapter 5, verse 3, which says, in these lay a great multitude of sick people, blind, lame, paralyzed, waiting for the moving of the water. For an angel went down at a certain time into the pool and stirred up the water. And again, in chapter 4, other stories of those who are sick, who are being healed. Also in the Gospel of John, we find the I Ams. The I Am is God's name in the Old Testament. When Jesus appeared to Moses and he asked him for his name, he said, I am who I am. So the fact that Jesus several times in the Gospel of John names himself as the I Am, it was a great reference to his divinity as well. So he would say, I am the bread of life, I am the door of the sheep, I am the good shepherd, I am the Son of God, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and I am the true vine. In conclusion, how do we look at the Gospel of John? We say that it is a gospel that presents Jesus Christ our Lord from glory to glory. From the beginning of the gospel, it says the Word became flesh and dwelt amongst us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. And towards the end of the gospel, the same concept of glory, he would pray in his intercessory prayer, chapter 17, verse 5, O Father, glorify me together with yourself, with the glory which I had with you before the world was. In summary, it's a very beautiful gospel. It's very remarkable. It has a lot of depth, a lot of understanding of Christology, of soteriology, again of pneumatology, the understanding of the Holy Spirit. We spoke also about so many other concepts that are so simple yet so deep, and a highly recommended gospel that enhanced our understanding of eternal life, of our love to God and love towards one another, and the nature of Christ. So we are going to take a quick break, 10-minute break, and we'll come back with your questions, and then we'll proceed to the next part of our presentation, Lord willing. See you in about 10 minutes. So, I guess there are no questions. First time, we don't have any questions. One question here. Where is the mic? Okay, question.
I have a simple question. when you read through the four Gospels, and I still have the question. It's just, why is man so wicked?
Sorry, can you say the question again? Sorry, I didn't.
Why is man so wicked?
Why is man so wicked? That's the million dollar question. I guess it's because of free will. Free will. Unfortunately, free will makes us make bad decisions and choices. But despite of man's wickedness, also we see in front of that God's everlasting love, which is portrayed throughout the scriptures. And also because as human beings we have the seed of God's image in us, there is also a lot of goodness in humanity. But God throughout scriptures would say we have a choice. We have to make that choice ourselves, whether we want to follow him or follow darkness. So we have the choice. And thank God for that choice. It's very important that we have that free will to make that choice. Any other questions?
Can I ask a question about God's kingdom? So when Jesus came and he's like proclaiming the kingdom of God is at hand, and just reading it in the textbook, this is from a couple of weeks ago, my question is, how would you define kingdom? Because when I've heard it defined, it's like that God's rule is present and that God wants to bring the good news of salvation. But wasn't that always God's plan? So why is that special, say, in the New Testament? Because God always wanted that and sent prophets and sent... You understand the gist of my question?
I think so. Let me answer and then I'll check if it's the right answer. I think the difference is the proclamation that God's kingdom is here. So that's what's so special about Jesus proclaiming the kingdom. That they've always wanted or looked forward for God's kingdom to come. But now that it is here, we must react to it. I think that's the difference between proclaiming that it's coming or actually saying that it is here.
Wasn't God's kingdom present in the Old Testament, though? Like with God, like it was fallen, but wasn't it also present? I guess what I'm missing.
I guess it depends on how we define kingdom, right? So there's something called theocracy. So now we're living in a democracy. The people govern themselves. A theocracy is God governs his people directly through the king, which he had, like, before that, he directly governed his people. So they did not have a king like the nations. And then the people started to ask for a king, like an earthly king. So God said, okay, you can have an earthly king. And he started with Saul, and then he had David. And David was a messianic figure that represented God's rule on earth. So God governs his people through a righteous king. And then after David came Solomon. And Solomon was not as righteous as his father. And the kingdom ended up dividing. And then we've seen the two kind of lineage of kings of Israel and of Judah, and most of them did not follow God's rule. So again, in principle, God's kingdom abounded on earth, but in practice, the people were so wicked, as we were speaking, that they denied God's kingdom. So by the coming of Jesus, he reclaimed that kingdom for God, and he said, now God rules through the Messiah, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who is coming for the salvation of the world. But he also said that my kingdom is not of this earth. So we have to keep that in mind, that it's not an earthly kingdom, it's an eternal kingdom. Okay? So he is a heavenly king rather than an earthly king. Okay, can we just pass the mic? Because we're streaming, I want people to hear the question, if you don't mind.
Gospel is customized to appeal to certain people or appeal to certain people. So it wasn't intended to be for anyone, everyone, anywhere, anytime.
That's the mystery of God's word, is that the original audience like the word of God, the Gospels, and also later the epistles, were written first for a specific kind of people who are in a specific kind of environment. But the mystery of the gospel, like St. Paul would say, okay, the epistle that I wrote for this city, read it also for that city so that they benefit from it. So by extension, the word of God has an everlasting understanding or an infinite understanding that it could be relevant to anyone from any city in any generation. Just this is what part of the inspiration is. It's God breathed, which is relevant to others. But I think the mistake that we usually make is that we jump on a text and say, okay, how does this mean? What does this mean to me here in the 21st century? And everything we've been trying to do in this course to say, okay, in order to have a fuller understanding of the scripture, of the word, let's see what it means in its original context first, and then we can contextualize it and see how it applies to other people in other places. But definitely, it has this infinite dimension to it. It's not only to be read for specific people at specific time. It's eternal.
Abuna, in chapter 17, the whole chapter is the Jesus prayer, and it's really long. So we my question is about how it got transcribed and transmitted to the Bible. It's so long, and we have to assume that he was praying out loud. But how is that all that information practically retained?
And there are several theories, right? Again, to add to your question, not only is it a long prayer, but it's also in another language. So this is a translation, because we know that Christ spoke Aramaic, not Greek. So the words that he prayed, not only did they have to be retained, but also translated to another language. So the theories are, number one, of course, as we might have read this week in the Stylianopoulos book, chapter 2, is the understanding of scriptures that it has divine impact. We can never take away that divine aid or help from writing the scriptures, but also it is written in a human style, okay? So he actually says that the scriptures are in somewhat comparable to the humanity and divinity of Christ. The divinity is, concerning scripture, is the divine inspiration and guidance of writing the words. And here we speak about what John spoke about the Holy Spirit, reminding the disciples of what to say, what to do, or the things that Jesus has said. So there's that aid or help from the Holy Spirit, which is definitely a part of it. The human aspect of it is that this could have been oral tradition. And by the way, oral tradition, if you know any background about Judaism or Jewish cultures, as well as Islamic cultures, kind of took that same concept. Oral tradition doesn't mean I hear a story and I say it back in my own words. When I hear a story, oral traditions means I memorize it to the letter. It's almost like today you are recording a recorded message or typing it out. That's what oral tradition, because they memorized the scriptures, let's say the law of Moses, to the letter. Like it's not that they just heard it and they recited the same story. So oral traditions mean that when you have something that is sacred, you memorize it and you teach it to others exactly as it is. So that's what oral tradition means. So one suggestion is that there was oral tradition that passed on, whereas eyewitnesses memorized it and they uttered to their disciples, not only here in this passage, but in other sayings of Christ throughout. The other theory that exists out there is the presence of an unknown written source, and this written source could have been called the book of signs, where it recorded or wrote down some of the signs that Jesus said, and then some of his sayings and his teachings, and then John would have used that as a resource to input it into his gospel, And also the other disciples, there's a theory which says that there's an unknown or lost gospel called Q. And this is a missing document, and no one knows what it is. And this was the source that the other gospel writers took and pulled away some of these miracles and sayings of Jesus. Again, the beginning of Luke says that there were so many people who kind of took it upon themselves to write accounts. So we know that there were other accounts of Christ that were available. But these are the four gospels that were canonized by the early church, and they were they became the standard for teaching about the life of Christ. So these are all theories and probably a collection of them where the real truth would be, I guess, at the end. Does it answer, or?
Abuna, can you tell us if you've read anything about the translation for Psalm 46? The whole idea with Shakespeare translating King James Version of the Bible and how he's put his name in there.
I think someone forwarded something to me recently about that. I hadn't known.
It goes
the beginning.
Something like this. Hold it. Shakespeare was 46 years old at the same time that St. James Bible was being translated.
Mm-hmm.
And that if you go to Psalm 46, and if you count from the beginning, you count the words 1, 2, 3, 4. Mm-hmm. The 46th word is shake.
Mm-hmm.
And then if you go to the end of the psalm and you count 46 words in, the 46th word is spear.
Mm.
And then there's some other theories that, and you can actually see it in the translations that chapter 1, let's say, verse 1 has S, and then the verse 2 has H, and then the verse 3 has A, and there's all sorts of these theories, and I mean, they're there, but I don't know if they're just there because it happened to be coincidence, or is there any proof that Shakespeare was, because he was a scholar at the time, and because he was a writer, and it was at the same time that this was translated.
Mm.
So I'm curious, as if you go back to the Greek, is the word shake there, and you know?
So.
And that's why I have a hard time with translations.
Yeah.
Because the translations to me is where the humanity comes in. Mm. You know, everybody's got their own way of.
We spoke last week about translations. So the Old Testament, including the Book of Psalms, is actually written in Hebrew, in the Hebrew language. So it's not Greek. Greek is the New Testament. The Old Testament is predominantly Hebrew. I think the best way to find out if this is by coincidence or not is to look at other approved translations of the Old Testament and compare to see if these words also appear or not. I haven't done any significant study or understanding concerning Psalm 46, but there are always theories of, you know, conspiracies or things that are embedded as signs in the Bible to point out to something or the other. I guess the best way is to look at another translation of this psalm, maybe in the NRSV or in the NIV, and to see if these words also appear or not. If we can't read them in Hebrew, then we can check them in another English translation.
But it went from Hebrew to English, or Hebrew to Greek and then English? It would go.
Yeah. Greek. So the first translation of the Old Testament, the Septuagint, was from Hebrew to Greek. That was the first one. And the one that was done in Alexandria, right? And then very briefly mentioned this last week. Let me see if I can pull it up. So you have the New Testament, was written in Greek, and then you have the Vulgate, which is the Latin version of the Bible, prepared chiefly by Saint Jerome at the end of the 4th century. And this was used by the authorized version of the Roman Catholic Church. So so probably it was translated from the Vulgate. The Vulgate was the Latin, yeah, so to English. But Greek was available for the translators at that time, for the New Testament. I'm not sure if Hebrew was available for them or not, so that's something that we can find out. But the available version for sure was the Vulgate, because it was translated in the 4th century. I think if you can go back to last week's discussion, we spoke about the different translations and versions. Maybe we can just leave it at that. Is there human error or factor? Ideally, we'll say no, but possibly there might be some things. And that's why it's really important to keep updating the translations to make them into a current language that everyone could understand and stay away. Like the translations that are made by groups rather than individuals. As individuals may want to play with the translation, but if it's a group or a community translating, then there's perhaps possibly not going to be anything like that. Any other questions? Any other? Continue. Okay, so for our second part of the presentation today, I wanted to discuss with you, who are the brothers of Jesus? And again, this is a word study, because the challenge that we have today is that when we are dealing with an English translation, it's very easy for persons of other Christian denominations to try to play around with the words as we understand them today and say, this is what it says. How come you believe differently? So it's really important always to go back to the original Greek translation to see what this word or these words meant in its original context. And then we can judge for ourselves if the doctrine of our church is correct or it is incorrect. I'm just going to move the attendance sheet around, if you don't mind, just signing in. So there are several verses in the New Testament that speak about the brothers of Jesus. First one is Matthew 13, 55 to 57. Is this not the carpenter's son? Is not this his mother called Mary? And his brothers, James, Joseph, or Joseph in another translation or manuscript, Simon and Judas? And his sisters, are they not all with us? Where then did this man get all these things? So he's speaking about the wisdom that Jesus had. So they were offended at him. But Jesus said to them, a prophet is not without honor except in his own country and in his own house. The same story mentioned in the Gospel of Mark says it a little bit or slightly different, a bit. So in the first version of Matthew, it says, is this not the carpenter's son? Here it says, is this not the carpenter? So referring to Jesus as the carpenter, the son of Mary, and brother of James, Joseph, Judas, and Simon. So it says the exact same words, and also refers to sisters, but the sisters are not known in this context. So they were offended at him, but Jesus said to them, a prophet is not without honor except in his own country, among his own relatives. So that part in the previous verse is not there. here it says, a prophet is not without honor except in his own country and in his own house. Here it says, a prophet is not without honor except in his own country, among his own relatives, and in his own country. So Mark actually clarifies that verse or that story a little bit by referring to his own relatives. So Jesus, you know, the people or the crowd were angry with him, and they refer to his knowledge. They know that he's a carpenter. They know his mother Mary, and they're just basically saying, we know his family. We know his family. So they refer to him being the brother of four people, and also he has sisters. But then in the second part of the verse where he says, in his own country, among his own relatives, and in his own house. So Jesus is clearly speaking here about these people that were mentioned as his relatives. So what's that word relatives mean in Greek? Sanginsin is a Greek word that means relatives or of the same kin, akin to, related by blood, in a wider sense of the same nation or a fellow countryman. So again, that word does not necessarily or always mean siblings by blood, but may mean relatives, okay, or kins, or people even of like a wider understanding of the whole nation or everyone who lives in the same city, etc. So the first reflection or reaction to the concept of these people who are called brothers and sisters of Jesus, number one, we are saying that Jesus refers to them as his relatives, not necessarily as his blood brothers or sisters. Furthermore, some other verses speak about the brothers of Christ or of Jesus. But I saw none of the other apostles except James, the Lord's brother. That's Galatians 1:19. And his brothers therefore said to him, depart from here and go into Judea, that your disciples also may see the works that you are doing. For no one does anything in secret while he himself seeks to be known openly. If you do these things, show yourself to the world. For even his brothers did not believe in him. So here's a reference to his brothers, that they were almost like wicked or wouldn't follow his teaching or his commandments. So who are all these brothers that he is referring to? Another verse, these all continued with one accord in prayer and supplication with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and with his brothers, again, Acts 1:14. And St. Paul would say, do we have no right to take along a believing wife, as do also the other apostles, the brothers of the Lord, and Cephas, who is Peter. So a lot of verses here that refer to the Lord's brothers. So we'll go back to the root word, which is Adelphos. A sister would be Adelphi. And we'll go to the lexicon and to see the uses of these words, brothers. So right out of the Greek New Testament lexicon, it says a brother, or that definition for the word Adelphos is a brother, whether born of the same two parents or only of the same father or mother. So that's one scenario. It could be a half a brother or a full brother. It doesn't have to be a full brother born of the same father and mother. So this encompasses all of the uses of the word Adelphos in the New Testament. Okay, these are all the different possibilities for the use of the word. Secondly, having the same national ancestor, belonging to the same people or countrymen. So basically being of the same tribe. Okay, if we're all from the tribe of Judah or any other tribe, then we are all brothers in that sense. And there are some references to that in the New Testament. Thirdly, a fellow believer united to another by the bond of affection. So we can be brothers in Christ. Okay. Fourthly, an associate or in employment or office. So we're basically working together. Or we've mentioned brethren in Christ. Also, it could mean brothers by blood. So it's not that It's not just relatives, but it could be brothers by blood. Or we can all be brothers in humanity. Okay, we are all part of this species. Okay, we're all brothers together. Any blood relation or kinsmen. Christians as those who are exalted to the same heavenly place. So even in the heavenly kingdom, we're all brothers in that sense. So again, that explanation from the Greek New Testament lexicon gives us all of the different possibilities for the use of the word Adelphos. So again, that's secondly, it's very important to know that at least the context of the word is not always used as, does not necessarily mean, because St. Paul can say brethren, okay? Like we are all brothers in Christ. So we use the exact same word of being Adelphos, used for the brethren of Christ. Sorry? Yes, so there's a spiritual sense where, yeah, there's a spiritual fatherhood, okay? You may call me father, but I'm not a biological father, okay? You could have a spiritual father, we could have a heavenly father, right? So the same word, but used in different contexts and understood differently. So some people have interpreted these brothers or sisters or brothers and sisters of Christ as children of Joseph from a previous marriage. But even though this is sometimes cited by Orthodox sources, yet there are some objections, which His Holiness Pope Shenouda actually writes. He says, number one, it's very difficult to say that Joseph had previous children because our Lord Jesus is the one who carried the lineage of Joseph. Okay, when it said in the Gospel of Luke, started out that Jesus is son. Okay, again, here's like all of these ancestry and blood relations. So we know that he is not biologically his son, but he carries his lineage. Okay, so Jesus being or known as the son of Joseph, and then he carries all the way up to Adam. So if this lineage was carried through Jesus, it means that he did not have any older brothers, because usually it's the oldest brother that carries the lineage. Secondly, there is no mention of all of these brothers and sisters in the infancy narrative. Okay, they're nowhere to be found. It was just Jesus and the Virgin Mary and our Lord Jesus, and the angel came to them and he said, take Mary and the baby child and go to Egypt, and there's no mention of them. Also, there's another story of Jesus going with his family to Jerusalem at the age of 12, where they kind of lost track of him, and there's no mention of any other children who were present at the time. And you find that all of these brethren or brothers and sisters appearing as adults. Okay, there's nowhere to be found until very much later on in the narrative, when Jesus started his ministry at the age of 30, and all of a sudden there are these references of the brethren of Christ. And also the last thing we think about is that if he had any biological brethren or siblings, our Lord Jesus would not have given care of the Virgin Mary to John the Beloved, because it would have been considered an insult to any sibling if you were just to take away the care of their mother and give it to a stranger, no matter who that stranger is. So it's obvious that there were no biological siblings at that time. So what's the probable explanation? So here we have to track a few verses in scriptures to know who are these siblings exactly, and how and why were they called the brothers or brethren of Christ. So we know for certain that James and Joseph, like two out of these four names mentioned as the brothers of Jesus, were not actually sons of Mary and Joseph. For the scripture identifies them as children of a different Mary, who was the wife of Alphaeus, or also named Cleopas, mentioned in Matthew 27, 56. And I'm just going to read very quickly this verse, the mention of these two specific individuals. 27:56, which says, among whom were Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James and Joseph, and the mother of Zebedee's sons. So here we see that we know already James and John, who are Zebedee's sons, and we know James and Joseph, and also their mom is another Mary. She's not the Mary, the mother of Christ. And also mentioned in Mark 15, verse 40. So now we know that these four individuals, at least two of them, are not biological brothers of Christ, and that's only what's written in the scripture. So by extension, we know that they are all not his biological brothers. 15:40 also reads, there were also women looking on from afar, among whom were Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James the less, and of Joseph, and Salome, who also followed him and ministered to him when he was in Galilee. So again, the same concept that at least two of them, we know they are not the biological brothers of Christ. James is also referred to as son of Alphaeus in the listing of the apostles in Matthew 10:3 and Mark 3:18, Luke 6:15, and Acts 1:13. And the relationship between these brethren, or including sisters, must be seen in the context of the Hebrew and Aramaic tradition, according to which even cousins were called brothers and sisters. There could have been no first blood brothers of Christ, otherwise he would not have given again his mother to John at the foot of the cross. The Old Testament prophecies explain the virginal marriage and ever virginity of Christ's mother. And we also have the testimony of the Holy Spirit speaking through the church that Saint Mary is the ever virgin. So the idea of the church theologians and fathers is that how is it possible that the only person who was called virgin in the twice in the Old Testament and twice in the New Testament turns out not to be a virgin at the end of the day? Also, there are many symbols in the Old Testament. Ezekiel saw that gate in heaven, the Lord entered and came out of it while it was still shut, and many other prophecies in the Old and New Testament that show that the Virgin Mary is an ever virgin and never changing. For further reading about this subject, I put there a couple of resources which we can always go back and read. The last thing, just before closing, someone asked about the Orthodox Bible last week. We spoke about different versions of the or translations of the Bible and which one to follow. So someone after the session asked, what about the Orthodox Bible? Is this a good translation? So actually, the Orthodox Bible uses the NKJV translation for its New Testament. So it doesn't, we don't have as Orthodox people a very specific Orthodox translation of the Bible, which is really unfortunate since we have the Greek knowledge at least, and we have now the Coptic as well, which should give us a fairly good translation of scriptures. As for the Old Testament, okay, so basically for the New Testament, it's using NKJV, okay, which is a Protestant translation with Orthodox commentary. So that's the good thing about this translation here. But then for the Old Testament, it uses St. Athanasius Academy Septuagint. Okay, so it's taking it from the translation from the Septuagint, which is the Greek translation of the Hebrew. And you will find that the order here is according to the Septuagint. Okay? It's not going to be the same because it includes the second canonical or what is referred to as the Apocrypha. So you'll find that the order of the Old Testament is different than the regular Bible. Anyhow, it's a really good, it's the best, I guess, mix that we have of all of the versions that are out there. If you can get your hand on one of these, it's really good. Otherwise, you know, go back to last week's discussion about all the different recommendations for the Bible translations. Reading assignment for next week, chapter 9, already in the book of Acts. And and also the book of Acts. God bless you all. Please kindly fold the tables and chairs. Have an amazing week, and be a light that shines in the darkness all the time. God bless you all. Let's pray together. And finally, O Lord, hear us as we pray with all thanksgiving. Our Father, who art in heavens, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not in temptations, but deliver us from the evil one. In Christ Jesus our Lord, for thine is the kingdom, the power, the glory forever. Amen. And now the love of God the Father, grace of his only begotten Son, our Lord, God and Savior, Jesus Christ, communion and gift of the Holy Spirit be with you. Go in peace. The peace of the Lord be with you all. God bless you.